see tonight, but we are all standing under a glass ceiling right now.
Almost half a century before Hillary Clinton became the first American woman to head up a major party's presidential ticket, Hillary Rodham was making history as the first ever student to deliver a commencement address at Wellesley College in 1969.
We feel that for too long, our leaders have viewed politics as the art of the possible. And the challenge now is to practice politics as the art of making what appears to be impossible possible.
Buried in it is the blueprint for so much of what would come in the future for Hillary Clinton that I think still resonates today when she's on the verge of perhaps becoming the first woman president.
Author Rebecca Traister describes Clinton's college years as a political transformation from her roots in this conservative Chicago suburb.
My father put everything he had into a small fabric printing shop in Chicago. My mother was out on her own working as a housemaid at the age of 14. So I grew up respecting the dignity of hard work.
Growing up, Rodham's politics mirrored those of her father, a staunch Republican. As a college freshman, she served as president of the Young Republicans Club. But she graduated as a liberal Democrat who would eventually work on George McGovern's 1972 presidential campaign.
She became a young adult in this era in which the great social movements of the 20th century were totally reshaping the nation, the civil rights movement, the women's movement, the gay rights movement. All of that was fomenting as she was coming to political consciousness.
After college came Yale Law School and worked with the Children's Defense Fund, where she knocked on doors collecting data about poor children. It was the start of a long string of public service work, work that political reporter Indira Lakshmanan says motivates Clinton to this day.
She is driven by certain things that are important to her: the welfare of women and children, health care for all Americans, income inequality.
As Hillary was forming her ideas about public service, a fellow law student named Bill entered the picture.
He was from Arkansas, and he wanted to go back and start his political career. And so in the early 70s, Hillary Rodham had this choice. Does she embark on her own career, or does she go to Arkansas, where she doesn't know anybody except for her boyfriend, and begin a career on her own as a lawyer, but really as a secondary figure to this man who's going to embark on what she thinks is destined to be a very serious and successful career in politics. And of course, we know she chooses to do the latter.
In October 1975, Hillary Rodham married Bill Clinton at their home in Fayetteville, Arkansas. While Bill followed his political ambitions, getting elected Arkansas's Attorney General, Hillary supported the family by joining a Little Rock law firm, where she became their first female partner.
There was no clear-cut path for a woman to just walk into politics on her own coming out of law school. And part of what Hillary Clinton now says about that is it just didn't really occur to her or seem like something that made sense, that she wanted to participate in making policy not as a headliner and not as a candidate herself, but as an advocate and kind of as a policy wonk.
When Bill was elected governor in 1979, Hillary took on an unofficial but active role, says former White House aide David Gergen.
For a long, long time, even before she got to the White House, when the Clintons were in Arkansas, and she was asked by her husband to take the lead on some various initiatives there, and she bravely went out and did that.
Indeed, Clinton appointed his wife to head up the Arkansas Education Standards Committee, where she worked to reform the state's public schools at a time when Arkansas was one of the lowest performing states in the country.
Because we're going to give them every chance we can to develop their minds so that they can play a role in this state and this country to make it the kind of place it needs to be.
By the end of his time as governor, Bill Clinton was praised for his education reforms, many of which came out of that committee, and public school performance had improved markedly.
the Clintons' argument has always been, even if unspoken, this sort of idea that you get a two-for-one deal with them. You get two people who are incredibly smart and well-educated, and again, whether you agree with their policies or not, are committed to certain policies and have been trying to work on those all their lives.
Thank you.
It was a theme Bill Clinton carried over to his run for the White House.
If we want a president who brings out the best in us, then I think the choice is clear. It's the next president of the United States, Bill Clinton.
But that working relationship, says Gergen, would take a toll on their marriage.
My sense was they had been so deeply involved in their public lives that they and there was so much going on that they really never settled what the rules of the road were when they came to the White House. And it was a volatile. It was a volatile relationship.
How volatile was not visible to the outside world. Before the Clintons ever stepped foot into the White House in 1993, and she was given her own West Wing office, there were hints Hillary Clinton would be a different kind of first lady.
I suppose I could have stayed home and baked cookies and had teas, but what I decided to do was to fulfill my profession, which I...
That candid comment early in the 92 campaign didn't go over well with voters, so she shifted to a more traditional role until Election Day. But as soon as her husband was elected, she was again a public player.
Hello, this is Hillary Clinton. I want to thank you for letting me speak with you about an issue that is central to our children's future.
Early on, President Clinton tapped his wife to steer a major initiative, running the Task Force on National Health Care Reform. David Gergen was an aide to the president at the time.
She's an extraordinarily competent woman. She's very much on, she knows the issues better than anybody I know, including her husband. That was threatening to some people. Some voters, men would, of the older generation would say, I would be really proud if my daughter grew up to be like Hillary Clinton, you know, to be the kind of pathbreaker she is. But I sure as hell am glad my wife isn't.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
In the beginning, the health care effort looked promising, says author Rebecca Traister.
When she first took on the project and initially testified in front of Congress about health care reform, it actually looked like it might go well. She was already a very divisive figure. People hated her. People loved her. She was so clearly smart, competent. Her approval ratings went way up. People liked it.
But as weeks passed, Clinton's health care plan was attacked by the right and the left. Conservatives called it a government takeover. Even with a Democratic majority in Congress, the bill never made it out of committee. Hillary had recruited dozens of experts to help craft an elaborate plan for universal coverage. But she had insisted most of the work be done in secret. David Gergen says it was that and the lack of political outreach that led to failure.
She hadn't learned yet to play the Washington game.
The collapse of the health care initiative was one of the major factors in the GOP's takeover of Congress the following year. During Bill Clinton's second term, Hillary was successful in her push for a program that enabled Washington to partner with states to ensure health coverage for uninsured children. But unlike the first 4 years, she spent less time in the West Wing and more time traveling abroad, much of it promoting women's rights.
It is no longer acceptable to discuss women's rights as separate from human rights.
Traister describes it as a retreat into a more traditional first lady role.
She and Chelsea did a lot of traveling around the world. She wrote a book called Dear Socks, Dear Buddy, Notes to the White House Pets. She was blamed so enthusiastically for what happened with healthcare reform, and she was really attacked so forcefully that it precipitated a real retreat by Hillary from this divisive public role that she'd held within the administration.
Hillary was also at the center of a string of controversies. The Clintons' involvement in a failed Arkansas land deal known as Whitewater would follow both of them through his presidency.
I think one of the most troubling moments for me at the White House came over the Whitewater issue.
Former White House aide David Gergen.
I had a conversation with the president, and we got his assent to give over the documents to the Washington Post. But then the president said, before we do this, you've got to remember this, both Hillary and I are involved in this. We can't release documents without her blessing as well. And by the way, David, you ought to go get it. I made the efforts to see her and try to persuade her to give over the documents, and I was ultimately very, very unsuccessful.
For years, Hillary Clinton resisted calls to release documents related to Whitewater and other controversies. That, in turn, drew more attention from the news media and ultimately led to the appointment of a special prosecutor.
If you stick to secrecy too much in the White House, and there's a temptation for every White House to do that, but if you stick too closely to temptation, you can pay a big, big price. And she paid a price for it.
The conventional wisdom about Whitewater always is take any straw you can to go on. So I don't have any doubt that there are those who will say this should go on. I just would like to tell them, go on where? We've been going on for 4 years.
The investigation ended after it was declared there was insufficient evidence to prove any wrongdoing. But the prolonged struggle led to a far more damaging controversy brought to light by independent counsel Kenneth Starr.
Had it not been for Kenneth Starr, we would never have heard of Monica Lewinsky. Had we never heard of Monica Lewinsky, Bill Clinton would have not been impeached.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky.
As the story of the president's involvement with a young White House intern unfolded, it set off a firestorm of headlines about the state of the Clinton marriage. Gergen describes their relationship as being a bit like a seesaw.
As long as the seesaw was in equilibrium, they worked well together. When Hillary got sort of hurt and lost a couple of things, and I lost the Congress, and the seesaw tipped like this, and Bill was up sort of on top, that's when I think he allowed himself to get, you know, to succumb to some of the temptations. There was a lot of volatility in a relationship. How well did she handle it? Well, she stuck by her man.
As the end of Bill Clinton's presidency approached, sympathy for the First Lady helped boost her image. She began openly planning her own political career.
Bill and I are closing one chapter of our lives, and soon we'll be starting a new one.
After supporting her husband's political aspirations for almost three decades, Hillary Clinton decided it was her turn. In February of 2000, while still in the White House, she threw her hat in the race to replace the longtime U.S. Senator from New York, Daniel Patrick Moynihan.
Lots of people assume that Hillary Clinton has always had this driving desire to be president, like her entire life has been shaped by an ambition to be in the White House. That may or may not be true, but what was certainly true was that it was not something that she could practically envision for herself. Her version of the story is that she did not consider taking on her own independent political career until the end of her husband's second term in the White House.
Less than 1 year later, with the soon-to-be former president by her side, Clinton became the first First Lady elected to public office. Former White House aide David Gergen calls Clinton's Senate years the finest and probably most satisfying years of her public life.
There's a famous phrase about when you go to the Senate, are you going to be a show horse or a workhorse? And she was very much the workhorse.
She served on the powerful Senate Armed Services Committee, worked to extend health care to National Guard members, and fought for expanded services for veterans and their families. But one vote in particular would plague her for years to come.
This is probably the hardest decision I've ever had to make. Any vote that might lead to war should be hard. But I cast it with conviction.
Clinton now calls her 2002 vote to authorize the use of military force in Iraq a mistake. But in 2007, when she first set her sights on the presidency, she doubled down on the Iraq decision. Reporter Indira Lakshmanan calls it a political miscalculation.
They thought it was a coronation. They thought that she was definitely going to have the Democratic nomination in the bag. And so they were already from the beginning trying to have her run almost like a general election candidate. They were trying to have her be centrist or even right of center, appeal to the so-called security moms. And they were still in this kind of post-9/11 mentality without realizing that that certainly Democrats were so disenchanted over the Iraq War.
The 2008 campaign quickly ran into something else that caught them off guard, a political newcomer named Barack Obama, who pulled off a surprise win in the Iowa caucuses. Clinton's loss there led to a memorable encounter with a voter ahead of the New Hampshire primary.
My question is very personal. How do you do it?
I couldn't do it if I just didn't, you know, passionately believe it was the right thing to do. You know, I have so many opportunities from this country. I just don't want to see us fall backwards.
It was at that moment that she showed her humanity and her vulnerability, and a lot of people credit that with turning the vote in New Hampshire around for her.
Clinton went on to win New Hampshire, along with 22 other states. However, it wasn't enough. Deeply disappointed, she waited till after the last Democratic primary in June to throw her support to Obama.
I move Senator Barack Obama of Illinois be selected by this convention by acclamation as the nominee of the Democratic Party for President of the United States.
But then she campaigned hard for him, and soon after his November victory, she agreed to become his Secretary of State.
I, Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Almost right away, Clinton appeared more natural as the nation's chief diplomat than she had been as a candidate.
As soon as she had a job to do and was a cabinet member of the United States, she seemed completely relaxed and completely focused on doing that job.
She worked to gain the respect of both foreign allies and adversaries.
Even when there were times in places where people were not happy about United States foreign policy and were not thrilled to see her, she, you know, didn't back down and apologize for U.S. policies. It was interesting to see her, even in difficult situations, sort of, do a sort of like jujitsu.
But with many complex global challenges, it was also a time of disappointments and failures.
She didn't get a Middle East peace deal. She didn't get an Iran nuclear agreement. That was something that happened under her successor, John Kerry. She didn't bring an end to the Syrian war. One wonders whether some of that is a very high bar to which to hold her, because some of those seem like they're intractable problems.
Clinton was also a driving force in the White House decision to militarily support the overthrow of Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi. President Obama now calls his administration's lack of planning for what came next the biggest mistake of his presidency. Libya spiraled into chaos, and 1 year later, the American consulate in Benghazi, Libya, was attacked. U.S. Ambassador Christopher Stevens and three other Americans were killed. Republicans slammed Clinton for not providing the outpost with sufficient security.
What difference at this point does it make?
We can all Monday morning quarterback look back at it now and say, was that a good decision? Was it not? On the other hand, had tens of thousands of people been slaughtered in Libya because the United States, France, and Britain and NATO had not come in, you know, the situation could have been worse.
Clinton stepped down from the State Department in February 2013. Amid speculation, she was readying another run for the White House.
I think what motivates her is to be a transformational woman leader. I think she feels that she's been trained for this all her life. He's been preparing for it. You know, talented men have stepped forward and had that opportunity. Time for a woman to be a leader.